So yeah, just to get back to the story, and I think of this story again, following the principles that Deleuze sets out in his reading of Nietzsche around difference in quantity, creating different qualities and leading to different wills to power. All right. So this is what the genealogy is doing. It's looking at, it's imagining a scenario where the difference in power between the strong and the weak lead to different qualities in the way in which they express their force and their strength, or their lack of strength, and therefore to different wills to power, and therefore different perspectives on the world, right? So it's from a certain kind of height, Nietzsche says, that the nobles have by being powerful, standing above those who aren't powerful, but not like looking down and paying attention to them, right? That they see the world differently. They see the world possibly as a world of struggle and strife, but they think of that as a good thing, right? So they affirm struggle, they affirm strife. Another thing that Deleuze will say is they affirm difference rather than opposition, right? They affirm a world of differences, right? Where difference is a matter of strength and weakness, and submission, reversal, all of those kinds of things. Because that's the world in which they act and they overcome, right? The slaves, from this base position, looking up in a way, and very resentful that they're in this base position, have created this completely different world, right? A, their power operates differently, it's reactive rather than active, right? And their will to power is one that will insist on seeing the world in oppositional terms. Here is good and evil, right? So the slaves invent this idea of intentional evil through which they can say the masters intentionally harm us. They can then say that we intentionally wouldn't harm anyone, so we're good, all right? And as Nietzsche says, the slaves, sorry, it's perfectly understandable that little lambs carried off by birds of prey would think the birds of prey are evil, except the birds of prey wouldn't think that way. And Nietzsche will go on to say, that's one of the points, right? There's a falsification that goes on, right? Where the slaves think that the nobles are doing something that the nobles, in fact, aren't doing. And Nietzsche will also say that, the other side of it is the nobles, insofar as they do see the slaves, the weak, they don't really understand them either, right? There is a kind of misunderstanding on both sides. But Nietzsche will say the slaves falsify the world itself by this invention of evil. Now, Nietzsche goes on to say, after this birds of prey, lamb discussion, that the great error in assuming this doer behind the deed, that the nobles had a choice in their actions, therefore the slaves had a choice in their actions, is it involves an abstraction of force relations, all right? Because his argument will be that to ask of strength that it not express itself as strength is just as foolish as to expect that weakness should act anything other than weak, that it should be strong, right? And that's what the slaves, he says, are doing. Because it gets back to that claim that Deleuze makes early at the beginning of the book. We each have the beliefs, feelings, and values that we ought to have given who and what we are. The nobles, he says, act in the way they do precisely because that's the way they are supposed to act. Just like birds of prey, when they eat lambs, are acting exactly the way they're supposed to act because that's what they are. They feed on them, right? It doesn't make them evil. It makes them, that's just what they do. And they couldn't do it otherwise, all right? And it's the same with the slaves. There's a trick that the slaves play where they say, I would never intentionally harm anyone, therefore I'm good. But the point is, they could never harm anyone anyway because they're weak, all right? So they've reinterpreted themselves in the same way that at the same time that they reinterpreted others. They do the sl and what they don't get, and this is where Nietzsche gives them has a certain sympathy. That's why he says it's understandable that the lambs would act this way. The slaves invent the morality that they would have to invent, given the fact that that's the way they're constituted, that that's their perspective on the world, a perspective that follows from the way in which they're constituted in this world of strife where they're the weak ones in relation to the strong ones. All right? So everyone, in a way, has the beliefs, feelings, and values that they're supposed to have, right? But these fault this fault the slaves have one which falsifies everything, all right? And you know, what Nietzsche will say about this all, as well, about the doer behind the deed, is a very important passage, and has re- it, it has a, it reflects Hegel as well, because the doer behind the deed is also, in a way, the essence behind the appearance. All right, it's the, it's a version of the same divide, which I mentioned, you know, Hegel doesn't believe in, mm-hmm. and Nietzsche doesn't believe in. Nietzsche will mm-hmm. say that it is an error of our grammar that causes us to create this doer behind the deed, right? Because we separate subjects from verbs. We treat the subject of an action as separate from the action. It's built into our grammar. We say John runs, all right? We say lightning strikes. That's an example that Nietzsche uses, but Hegel uses also. Now, by the way, this idea of grammar, I should mention, also is reflected all the way back to Plato. That whole thing about what is beauty, and that's not the right question, and that's how Plato comes up with his idea of beauty as an essence and as a timeless form. Nietzsche would say that that's also from our language, from the fact that we can ask what is beauty. That's part of it's written. It's the grammar of our language that allows us to treat beauty as a substantive thing that we could then say is different from examples of beauty, right? Is somehow separate from it. Right? Here, it's the action is somehow different from the actor. The actor is different from the action, therefore the actor could act one way or act another way. The example lightning strikes is a good one, or lightning flashes, sorry. And the reason why that's good is it suggests that there's a lightning, which is a thing, that flashes. But what is lightning? Lightning is a flash of light. So to say lightning flashes is a redundancy, all right? Lightning has to, you know, that's what it is. Lightning is its own, is the action of flashing. But it's a seduction of our grammar, Nietzsche says, that causes us to assert that there's a doer behind the deed, and therefore to assert this idea of choice, therefore to assert that it's a matter of choice whether someone chooses to be good, chooses to be evil, and so on. You know, a different way of thinking about this is it's an old English expression, from his actions you shall know him, right? So, and in a way, a person is nothing but their actions, right? There's not a core somehow behind their actions that's different. Or it would be odd to say that it was different. An example of this one, probably you won't know this one, it's an American reference. I don't know if you would have ever heard of someone named Dan Quayle. Dan, you've heard of George Bush, the president who, that war and other things. You know that George Bush, the George Bush of the 2000s, was the son of a George Bush who was president from 1988 to 1992. That George Bush in 1998 to 92 had a vice president named Dan Quayle, who he nominated when he was running for president. We brought on board when he was running for president. And Quayle immediately became a national figure of idiocy. He seemed like a very unintelligent person. He said stupid things. When he was vice president, the administration he was capable of being so embarrassing that the administration like never sent him out to like do things that normally vice presidents would do. He would talk to like 7-year-olds, to like kindergarten kids and stuff. Even then he would embarrass himself. One of the famous examples was he went to a kindergarten class where they were doing spelling lessons, and there was a little 4-year-old who had to spell potato, P-O-T-A-T-O. You know this word because you have potato in so many of your foods, right? And Quayle says in front of these cameras, you left out an E, and he made the kid spell potato T-O-E. It's like in front of the camera, everybody's like, my God, the guy doesn't even know how to spell potato. And it was even worse, because the kid afterwards was like talking to the camera, yeah, I knew didn't have an E, but he insisted that I write the E. Anyway, he was a national joke. He was a joke in many ways that the George Bush who was president in the 2000s was considered a joke. Okay, now here's the thing, to get back to the Nietzsche, how this ties in with Nietzsche. There were people who tried to defend Quayle. Even Al Gore, who was Clinton's vice president, because Quayle had been a congressman and a senator, so people knew him, but he wasn't a particularly prominent figure, so it was really a shock he became vice president. He was largely unknown, but obviously other senators knew him. And, you know, Gore was like, yeah, he's a smart guy. You don't see it on TV, but he's a smart guy. And the thing is that if you follow the rule from his actions, you know him. It's just a bizarre claim, because it seems odd to say that someone who says who just says stupid things all the time is not in fact stupid, right? If maybe in some hidden corner of the world, Quayle occasionally said smart things, preferably those that were caught on camera, then like you might be able to say he's sometimes stupid, he's not stupid, right? But it would seem odd to say, and this is a different version of it, there's no doer behind the deed. The action is everything. If the actions are always stupid, the person is stupid, right? Et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? There's no essence behind. The appearance is everything. The action is everything. There's no hidden essence behind the appearance, all right? Now, you could say, all right, maybe he's pretending to be stupid. But even then, that would be a new, you know, insofar as he's acting, that says what he is. He's an actor. He's a guy who pretends all the time, right? He's disingenuous. He's fake, right? But even then, that wouldn't imply that there was a true, you know, if you see what I'm saying, right? His actions define what he is, all right? So that's the error that the slaves make, that they have to make, because from their position in the world, they have this moral binary, which is a perfectly natural thing for them to invent, but it has these consequences, right? It has other consequences in that. Nietzsche will talk about this whole distortion of the world that takes place off of the idea of intentional evil, the subject behind the action, and the actions being a binary of good or evil, right? The first has already been said, in a way. The slaves, Nietzsche says, reverse all values because they label good everything they are forced to be. So they're weak. They can't harm anyone, and they call it humility. And they have to obey because they're not strong enough to stop if someone wants them to do something. They can't really resist physically. And so they make a virtue out of being obedient, right? Everything that they are forced to be because they're weak, they turn into a virtue. And they are the exact opposite virtues of what the nobles consider virtuous, right? The nobles consider virtues acting, struggling, overcoming yourself, you know, fighting onward, being, you know, there's an honor attached to all of that, right? And they think of all of those things as dishonorable, all right? Now, there's an additional thing that happens, though, which is that, and all of this that is a notion of revenge that will come out of this. So I think this gets to this whole forgiveness thing that you were mentioning before. The slaves, Nietzsche refers to this as ressentiment, which is the French word for resentment. The slaves invent all of this because of their ressentiment, their resentment over the fact that they're weak. And what resentment is, Nietzsche says, is it's their will to power and their forcefulness, their drive, pushed back into them because they're weak, because they're too weak to express it, because they're forced to submit, it's pushed back into them. But it doesn't disappear, all right? It doesn't, they are still, you know, beings of will, which have a will to power, they're still beings who are forceful, they have to express it in a different way. So again, they don't express it by being physically forceful. They invent it by this kind of clever way of justifying themselves in their weakness. They become creative, right? And what Nietzsche says is that doesn't get rid of the spirit of revenge that they have. So after first labeling others evil and calling themselves good and valorizing themselves in their weakness, they then invent a whole story of revenge against those who are strong. So they forgive them, you are right about that, but they also invent this idea of a god who will avenge them in a judgment day, right? And what Nietzsche will say is the fact that God is there to punish the evil, which who they can't punish anyway because they're weak, allows them to continue to say they love the people that they secretly hate, and to forgive them for their sins and all of that. So Nietzsche quotes Tertullian, who was a church father before Augustine, I think 2nd century. Tertullian was also excommunicated. He became a heretic. He was labeled a heretic and kicked out. But before that, one of the things he writes, Nietzsche quotes, some of the English translations is quoted in Latin, and then there's a footnote giving the English translation. Other translations, they don't give you the Latin. But Tertullian is talking about the judgment day, when those who are going to be saved are saved, and those who are going to be condemned to hell are condemned to hell. And he talks about how happily, like, we'll all be sitting around eating our food, having a picnic, while all those people will be burning in hellfire, and they'll be screaming, yeah, and we'll be just laughing and having a good time. And Nietzsche refers to this as like the ultimate, just nasty, vengeful spirit, right, that they have, right? All because they couldn't act, right? They imagine their revenge. That's another aspect of it. Because they cannot outwardly defeat the nobles, the strong, they imagine the revenge instead, all right? And again, it's perfectly natural. I'll give you another example. This is a story I kind of like telling. When I was a PhD student, I was living in a hall of residence in central London, and we were in the dining hall, and this guy I knew had come in, and he had been mugged. So he had gone to an ATM machine, and he had foolishly, well, not foolishly, but just by bad luck, had withdrawn the maximum amount, which was £250, from his account. Now, it's probably the same here. The card comes out, and you have to pull the card out, and then the cash comes out, right? So he does this. The card pops out. Someone from behind him grabs the card and pulls it out, and you know, then the money pops out. He turns around. There's like six or seven guys, you know, who are there to take his £250. And, you know, he really had no choice but to give them the money. You know, there were seven of them. He could have been beaten up. They could have had knives. Like, it was a perfectly rational thing for him to do. But, you know, it's traumatizing as well. And he came back. He was really upset, you know, at the whole incident. Obviously, a very upsetting incident. You feel very weak in that kind of a situation. And I was sitting there with him at the dinner table. And he then said, you know, I could have karate chopped one of them in the neck, and I could have kicked one of them in the balls. It's like, yeah, and then the other five of them would have beaten the hell out of me. But he really came up with this scenario. I could have beaten them all up. And I guarantee you, he probably went to sleep that night, and he had a dream that he beat up these seven people, right? Which is impossible. It's his fantasy, right? The fantasy revenge is what is going on with the slaves, all right? This moral world order, this fantasy revenge, this god that they invent. And this is the point. The god that they invent is the all-powerful god of Judaism and Christianity, who is transcendent, right? All the things that traditional religion and Western religion and philosophy are dealing with, right? The idea of a transcendent absolute, the binary opposition between good and evil, seeing the world in these kinds of oppositional terms, and again, Deleuze and Nietzsche's claim is opposition is a moralization of the world. From Deleuze's perspective, it doesn't matter that you could then come along and show dialectically that good isn't just the opposite of evil, because you couldn't have good without evil, and you couldn't have evil without good, and therefore they're separate, but therefore they're also unified, and God can't really be transcendent because he's also part of the, you know, in not being in the world, he also is in the world, and, you know, the absolute is the world itself, and there's no outside. The dialectical solution misses the fact that the world is only seen from a certain perspective as being oppositional, right? And that, you know, in Nietzsche's sense, the whole way of seeing this world in these terms is erroneous, is false. Okay. So, yeah. I figured I wouldn't have a lot of time to do this, but I'll do it briefly. I mean, I'm not covering, by the way, every single sentence of the Nietzsche and philosophy book. There's a lot more that to get into. A whole thing around psychology, whole aspects around critique and around overcoming and the like, the other essays of the genealogy of morals and so on. The idea of the dice throw. But what I will say is, what Nietzsche always talks about is, he talks about overcoming this binary of good and evil, right? He talks about how this overcoming of good and evil, which he refers to as going beyond good and evil, He says it doesn't mean going beyond good and bad, which doesn't mean that it's the same thing as good and bad. But he talks about, and Deleuze will talk about this too, an idea of overcoming these kinds of moral categories and moral binaries and this oppositional way of thinking about the world with its the conceptions of truth and the conceptions of the absolute that it entails. And for Nietzsche, for Deleuze, that requires a transmutation of the will to power from a negative will to power based on raisonnement that invents these oppositions to an affirmative one that affirms difference, right? And what Nietzsche will say is that this transmutation is also linked to the affirmation of the eternal return, right? Now, the eternal return, I'll talk to you about it for 7 or 8 minutes. I'll try and talk to you more about it tomorrow when we discuss it in relation to the ideas of difference and repetition, the first two chapters of difference and repetition. Deleuze offers many different formulations of what the eternal return is. The basic formulation, Nietzsche says, well, he gives two kinds of ideas. I mean, one is as a doctrine of the way the world is. Some people call it the cosmological doctrine. Nietzsche says time is infinite because it doesn't have a beginning, it doesn't have an end. If it had a beginning, we would have reached the end by now, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So time is infinite, he would suggest, forward and backwards. Given an infinite time, all events and things in the world will recur. Now, I should say that this is one of the ways he formulates it. Deleuze says that this is, and there's textual evidence for this, that this isn't really the full meaning of the doctrine. It's one formulation of it, which in fact Nietzsche says is a scientific formulation that's not really the one he's endorsing. But it is treated oftentimes as a cosmological doctrine that in an infinite time, all things will happen again and again and again. Is given an infinite time, we'll all be in this room again, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? It's a physical doctrine in that sense. Another formulation Nietzsche gives is as an ethical doctrine, which is as a test. Could you will the eternal return or affirm the eternal return? And that's one which is closer to the idea of overcoming. You can overcome your own resentments about the world if you can affirm the eternal return. And what that means is whether or not we really will be here again in some period, again in the infinity of time, repeating this in an infinite number of times, could you will it to be the case? And that's why Nietzsche says that one way of thinking about the eternal return is it changes every it was into thus I willed it, and thus I will its eternal return. Whatever has happened, I would will for it to happen again. All right? And that ethical version is one that in a way Deleuze does endorse. While also qualifying it by talking about other aspects of the eternal return. In Nietzsche and philosophy, there are a number of formulations Deleuze gives. I'll go through them just very briefly, and you can note them down, and we'll talk about this again in more detail. I think I mentioned this at the beginning. Well, not quite at the beginning. Deleuze refers to the eternal return as the being of becoming, right? So becoming, change, the will to power is the principle of becoming. I think I did mention this at the beginning. The will to power is the principle of becoming. The eternal return is the principle of the being of that becoming, right? Or it's the principle or the structure of that becoming. All becoming takes the form of returning or repeating. You need to understand what that means. We'll try and discuss that, I think, more tomorrow. All right? He also refers to the eternal return as expressing a principle which serves as an explanation for diversity and its reproduction, or difference and its repetition. And, Deleuze's main work of key early work is the book Difference and Repetition. The eternal return is the principle that explains difference and its repetition. All right? He talks, too, about it tying together necessity and contingency. And in this sense, we could relate it to destiny in the way we talked about before. Destiny was a kind of sense of things, or a temporal aspect of the sense of things that was different from the facts of the matter. So Ali, Foreman beat Frazier, but Frazier could have beaten Foreman, right? Or Ali won the fight. No one thought he would win the fight. There's this whole contingency element, his unpredictability to the fact that he won the fight. But once he wins the fight, there's a way in which it seems like, of course, he won the fight. Like, it made sense that he won the fight, right? So the eternal return kind of ties those two things together. It offers an ethical principle as well. So there's this whole idea of willing the eternal return. You can do will things to return again. What Deleuze will say about this is what the eternal return selects is that difference will return, but opposition won't return. Or affirmation will return, but negation will not return. And the reason why he says that is the will to power of the negative will to power, if it returns, is because it transmutes itself or changes. The affirmative will to power is the force of changing, right? Because the nobles are always overcoming themselves. So to say affirmative powers return is precisely that, overcoming returns. The negative doesn't return because it only returns by overcoming itself. So it kind of selects in that way. And finally, he speaks of the eternal return as a second order sense. The will to power expresses the sense of the struggle of forces, right? That struggle, the quantitative differences giving rise to qualitative distinctions, includes a will to power that expresses the sense of that struggle, right? And that sense could be affirmative or it could be negative. The eternal return is the structure of that sense, right? It's the form that all forms of sense take, for example, right? And I think that will make sense tomorrow, because Deleuze in Difference and Repetition says that the eternal return is the structure of time. It's the form that all temporalities take, right? And the form that all events take and the like. One other aspect about the eternal return, though, and I think, yeah, I can do this. It'll take a few minutes to make the point. Nietzsche will talk about the eternal return as a structure, but he will also talk about it in terms of a kind of process. And the process, he does say, is circular. It seems to be a circle. There is an aspect of that. But it's also a transmutation. It's always a circle that changes something, right? And the key is to understand what is changed in it. And what's changed in it is the self, or the subject. Nietzsche, in Difference and Repetition, Deleuze will refer to the eternal return as the time and the structure of the aborted cogito. You know, the cogito of Descartes, I think, therefore I am. This is the aborted one, the one that fails to become a subject, all right? And Deleuze will say that affirming the eternal return always means dissolving the subject as a subject, all right? What does this mean? I think I can explain it to you in a couple of minutes, 3 or 4 minutes. All of us go through shit in life, right? And one of the things that Nietzsche says about this is, well, all of us go through shit in life, and that shit can be quite shitty, and it can encourage raisonnement. And raisonnement is always, all figures of the subject involve forms of raisonnement. Resentment is a resentment about what happened to me. Resentment is, why did this shit happen to me? All right? When Nietzsche talks about the eternal return, one of the things he says, he doesn't actually mention eternal return here, but he says what's indispensable in life is that a person finds satisfaction with who and what they are. Because whenever they don't find satisfaction with who and what they are filled with resentment, and we others have to suffer from that. All right? In a way, finding satisfaction with who and what you are has to also involve accepting your past and including all the crap that got you there, all right? So, but what happens in that is that it doesn't mean that the terrible things that happened in your past aren't terrible. It means that you manage to distance yourself from the me, right? So, I mean, I don't know. I'll mention this just very briefly. I'll probably mention it before. I went through a divorce, which was this horrible, traumatic thing. For me, it was. And I felt very betrayed. Yeah, I can go on many details about this, which I won't go on here. But, you know, and this is a true aspect about time. Like, at some point, what happened was still terrible, but I can begin to think it didn't happen to me. It happened to some other guy. Like, a guy I liked. but like a guy who's not here anymore, because I'm the one who's changed, right? Because I'm become something else, right? And that in a way gets obscured by the point, accepting that you've changed takes a certain weird form, which is you turn what happened to you into something that you would be willing to have happen again and again and again. And the reason you'd be willing to have your past happen again and again and again is because you have a satisfaction with what you are now. Does that make sense? Does it make a certain kind of sense? So, you know, there's this aspect of it in which the eternal return is a transmutation of the past into something else, which is linked to the fact that you also overcome your resentful attachment to it, right? And, you know, that's why Deleuze will talk about it in those terms, that the affirmation of the eternal return is always the dissolution of the self, right? It's a dissolution of the self's attachment to its past. And that's why it's also, he'll say, always concerns the future, because it always involves a kind of release of the past from, you know, from being the determinant of the future, right? It brings something new into the world in that way. Does that make a little bit of sense? Now, I also said the eternal return is the structure of time, which I'll get into tomorrow what that actually means. In that respect, the eternal return as the structure of time is the way in which, is the guarantor that that kind of overcoming is possible, right? That the past does not necessarily weigh on the present and on the future in that way. There's actually, I'll close with this one kind of very beautiful phrase in Nietzsche. I should have pulled it out. I forgot to. Because I think the eternal return in some ways and overcoming is summed up in this one passage. It's a really beautiful passage from The Will to Power. Let me just get the right book out. And it has its own connection to everything else we've talked about like how everything is related to everything else, but these are relations of force and these are relations of difference. This is it. It's from The Will to Power. It's The Will to Power, section 1032, if you want. Nietzsche writes, "If we affirm one single moment, we thus affirm not only ourselves, but all existence. For nothing is self-sufficient, neither in ourselves nor in things. And if our soul has trembled with happiness and sounded like a harp string just once, all eternity was needed to produce this one event. And in this single moment of affirmation, all eternity was called good, redeemed, justified, and affirmed." Right? Including your crappy past. Right? All of it was required to affirm, to create the moment that you find affirmation. Right? And that's how it's linked. That's how the willingness to affirm your past again and again and again is the willingness, is redeemed precisely because, you know, is a kind of redemption of your past precisely because everything is connected to everything else. If you find your moment of satisfaction, if you find your moment of happiness, the entire universe was required to produce it. That's, again, that gets back to that point Nietzsche makes, that the person who says, "I wish so-and-so were different," is arrogant enough to say, "I wish the whole universe were different." And like, that's the supreme arrogance, is to be resentful towards what other people are, what the world is, right? It's the ultimate, to be resentful about what other one person is to be resentful about the entire universe, right? Yeah?
So then should I also say that from what you have just discussed,
yeah,
then somewhere down the line, we are also accepting the fact that there is a possibility of change, improvement, progress, and
yeah,
that way, agency is also
Yeah, possibly. It depends on what you mean by all of those things. Because, again, all of those things have different senses. So, I mean, can there be change? Yeah, because there always is change. I mean, one of the things about the eternal return as the structure of time is that it guarantees that things always change.
It's not
right?
Change.
Sorry?
It's also like a progress,
yeah.
An improvement.
Yeah, it depends what you mean by that. Because many ideas of progress are just the resentful man's idea of progress. So it depends on what you mean by that, right? But yeah, I mean, certainly, maybe one way of putting it is, yeah, it could, and this is a Foucauldian way of putting it, is certain things can progress in local, limited, contingent ways, but the Enlightenment idea of like mankind's like singular progress is a senseless, you know, idea, right? You know, even when Foucault talks, you know, Foucault, when he talks about the rise of disciplinary society, he refuses to call it progress, not because certain things didn't improve, but because it's wrong to think of like the entire arc of these changes as progress, right? Progress is seen as this universal, right? And things changed in ways which are both good and bad, right, at the same time.
Some kind of agency is finally conceded, I guess.
Sorry?
Some kind of agency is finally, you know, accepted that there is possibility of an agency.
Yeah.
Isn't it? I mean, since
you... Yeah, okay. Well, yeah, okay.
Work on the resentment, opposition.
Oh, okay. In that sense. Okay, I thought you kind of meant more like, is there social progress? You're talking about, like, just, is there agency in this? Yeah, there is, but there's no subjectivity. Like, that's the whole point. Like, agency and the subjectivity is a form of ressentiment. Agency exists, but agency is incompatible with this idea that the subject is the agent, right? You know, and so it's, you know, that's the kind of tricky one, because most ideas of change, improvement, and decision, whatever, are grounded in the idea of the subject, right? The subject as the agent of history. Mm-hmm. I think Nietzsche would reject that, right?
What I've also found from this discussion is that somewhere, you know, Nietzsche is having a faith in the individual, whereas in the case of Deleuze, I think losing that faith, and he's believing that no change is possible, whereas Nietzsche is at least, you know, conceding that true will to power the possibility.
Sorry, Deleuze thinks that no change is possible.
Nietzsche is at least...
I need to give you 3 more lectures and prove to you that that is not true. I hope to prove to you that that is not true in 3 more lectures. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, change is possible, but certain kinds of universal judgments that this change is unambiguously X and that change is unambiguously Y, he would not endorse. But that doesn't mean that change doesn't happen. It doesn't even mean that things don't get better and worse. It means kind of absolute judgments of this is progress, that's not progress. There's always more ambiguities to the situation than to judge that. And that's why, I mean, there's a line in Nietzsche and philosophy about that Nietzsche says he doesn't believe in great events. He only believes in kind of little, in like a multiplicity of meanings for every event, right? And the idea of the great event that has this singular meaning is one that doesn't hold water for them. Right.
The last point, when you talk about, say, philosophy in the third world context, you know, the one interesting fact about the philosophy in the third world context is that we do not arrive at philosophy through, you know, metaphysics as such, because of the, you know, the colonial and the post-colonial experiences,
okay,
and, you know, the resistance movements of, you know,
right. You say that we don't arrive at philosophy from...
through metaphysics, but through politics, you see.
Oh, yeah, through politics, yeah, of course.
Yes. For example, if you have to think about the subjectivity in the third world context, you have to come back to the issue of condition of subjectivity and all that. So in that way, the issue of outside is so crucial for us. You know, we have to think about, you know, the space of outside. Otherwise, you know, what should we think?
No, fair enough. I mean, like...
So how to think of, you know, outside? Is it possible or some kind of delusion? And
There is a delusion outside that we'll get to. The war machine is outside the state apparatus, is exterior to the state apparatus, and we'll have to think about what that means. I mean, for starters, yeah, I mean, it is true that I'm presenting you with philosophical and metaphysical backgrounds to Deleuze's thought, but yeah, I would think it's, you know, I would think the philosophy comes out of political and other experience first. I mean, I'd accept that, even though what I'm presenting to you isn't that. And so yeah, fair enough on that point. Sorry, what was it? What was the next thing you said? It was
How to imagine or feel on the
Oh
space
yeah, the
of
exteriority.
culture or with Deleuze.
The thing you need to understand in Deleuze, the thing you need to kind of we need to figure out, hopefully, is two statements that Deleuze makes that seem to be incompatible, and yet understanding Deleuze is understanding how they fit together. The one is that, you know, there is nothing but immanence. The world is immanent, right? There's no transcendence. The other is, for example, thought is a violence that comes from the outside, right? So the real thing is to understand that a philosophy of immanence includes something called the outside, but the outside is not, has to be understood differently, right? So what is that outside? What is an immanent outside, so to speak? Like that's the difficult one. The outside is usually seen in a spatial sense, like your garden is outside your house, but that's not the kind of outside that Deleuze is talking about. And so, yeah, that's the difficult thing to get a hold of. But yeah, there is something that is an exteriority, that is an outside, that has a character of that. But we have to get more at what that is and what it means. Yeah.
Otherwise, you cannot properly theorize a third world politics.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, entirely.
You yeah.
Cannot attempt for that.
Yeah.
At least.
Yeah. 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 Sure. Sure. Okay.